and why NoSQL become the popular aspects. Okay, we will try to understand what is NoSQL, why there is a sudden need for lots of new kinds of databases. So for example, we have been used to DBMS. Before that there was a DBMS, and before that there was just only file systems. Okay, so now it is NoSQL. Okay, so there was a growth going like this. We also seen that typically previously it was access like this, a tape. So tape was there, so it was a linear access. Then came disk. So this was sequential access. This was random access. Okay, so now random access gave rise to lots of random fastness in the in your random access provided you the capability to look into any record. So for random access to work, we have two activities. First one is to do a seek, and second one is to do a transfer. These two activities are needed. So we looked into that. So what we figured out, the seek time in the past 30 years, okay, the improvement is less. Is less. Okay, transfer rate has increased. Okay, today 100 Mbps transfer is very easy, that is from disk to memory is faster. Okay, so now if this is the case, what happens is that of these two things, this seek time is going to, for all any big operations, if for any big data operations, seek time is going to be the limitation. Seek time determines how fast it can be done. Okay. So since seek time has not improved in the past 30 years, so your any operations, anything that you advances into hardware or any other thing, it's always going to be depend upon the seek time. And for some reason, suddenly what happened is that over a period of time, there was always a need for RDBMS. Okay. Now suddenly what happens is that there was a huge data growth. Huge data growth was there. So with huge data growth, there was two problems. So one is you had the problem of storing data, and second one is the problem of processing data. So to store data, people came up with a distributed file system. This is what we call as a Hadoop distributed file system. And to process this whole data is where Hadoop MapReduce came into picture. Okay, this thing was done. But what happens is this has a limitation. There is a limitation. Okay, Hadoop is good for, okay, storing large, I mean large in the sense of huge data in petabyte scale, and it can do the processing on huge files. The limitation is, okay, it can do only batch processing. Okay, so no matter how much data it is possible, the and batch processing, and then that is data can be looked only in sequential manner. Okay, and entire data set has to be looked even for simplest job. Okay, so this is the limitation. Okay, so people, when they created huge database, huge systems for storing and retrieving and all kinds of data, then people wanted, okay, it is fine that I can store huge amount of data, I'm fine with even batch processing, but I want, so what happens is that it's like this, okay, huge data, after processing, produces huge data, okay. Even this data has to be sequentially analyzed. So this is where people wanted a change. Okay, people said that at least the results of processing, I should need something like an RDBMS. That is, we can look into any point of data in order of one lookup time. Okay, now people said that since this is what the requirement is. Okay, so this is where the projects like Cassandra, projects like Hbase, projects like Dynamo, projects like MongoDB, projects like CouchDB, so many things. Okay, these are all examples of NoSQL databases. Okay, which means that it not only stores a huge amount of data, but also provides a capability to look into those data in a random fashion. Okay. So is that clear, that from where this overall Hadoop and how Hadoop solved the problem, and then how it also paved path for the next set of things to come into place. So this is where we kind of left in the last week. Okay. So we went a little bit detailed. So we also covered on aspects like, okay, how there was a search engine, and then how there was an inverted index to be built, and quite a lot of other Hbase theories. Okay, so what we covered in the last classes. So you're able to see my slides, right? So what we covered in our last classes is that what is NoSQL? Why asset properties are no more relevant for us? And do we have web apps that are different than yesterday's application? And what changed recently? So what changed recently? We got massive data volumes and with extreme load queries. And when there is a massive amount of data, the main problem bottleneck was predominantly into the joins. Okay, and schema evolution. Okay. So what happened was schema evolution was people wanted. So we looked into schema evolution. Schema evolution is a concept that goes very well with the Hadoop ecosystem. Okay. So what happened?
You said like Hadoop is only for batch processing.
Yes.
And I mean, it looked only in sequential manner, something like that. So can you please give some more details on like Hadoop, how Hadoop, Hbase and RDBMS, can you please elaborate more on these three areas so that we can clearly understand where and why?
Sequential system, right? Okay, so let's talk about a simple thing. Okay, Hadoop. Okay, so what is Hadoop designed for? Hadoop is predominantly designed for processing huge amount of files. Okay, and huge amount of files can be processed only if you are able to divide the files into multiple blocks. Okay, and then process the individual blocks. Okay, so this is the concept. Okay, this is a conceptual model. So what happens if this is a big file to be processed? I have to split this file like this. You can say B1, B2, B3, and B4. Okay, so the first problem is that if I have to split this and then do it, I can do this only when my whole concept of processing this file can happen in a sequential manner. Okay, if it is going to happen in random manner, I may not know where to start. Okay, so if my problem is like, if I have to do randomly, I can't split it first of all. So first of all, to split individually and process it, I need to do a sequential processing. So I split this. Okay, so now B1, B2, B3, B4 is there. This is given to computer 1, this is given to computer 2, given to computer 3, given to computer 4. Okay, what can also be there is, this B1 itself can further be divided into B01, B02, B03. Okay, maybe multiple threads can look into this. Okay, so multiple threads can look into that. So what has to happen is that, to split and process, I need to divide and then work on it. The processing should be sequential alone. Okay, that is one aspect of it. The second aspect is, all I'm doing is analytical. Okay, so the thing is that predominantly, when I see, so it is like an aggregate operation. Okay, so aggregate operation. Say for example, a simple example will take sum. Okay, to do sum, okay, say for example, if I have an array like this, okay, sorry about my drawing. Say for example 1 7 8 6 2 1 3 2 1. If I have an array like this and to count the sum of this array, I have to visit all elements. Okay, and when I have to visit all elements, okay, when I have to visit all elements, it's good to do sequential. Okay, so I start from here and then I keep reading like this. Okay, so what happens in a typical RDBMS is, that is why you have an array kind of a data structure. Okay, so you read this whole thing into memory and then keep it and then reading it. Okay, so it is one single read and then do it. Say for example, if this is not just 10 elements, imagine there is 1 million elements. Okay, so one in the disk, this 1 million stored in this disk, it may not stored completely into one block. Okay, this 1 million entry in the disk will be stored somewhere here, so many places it will be kept. Okay, so the operating system has to do multiple seeks and transfer this. Okay, so it has to do the multiple seeks and transfer to do this counting. So in Hadoop, what people decided is that, okay, because it is a disk, it has to do this. If I am doing like this, I will be spending all my times in this seek, which is the slowest component. Okay, it is like this. In the marathon, your fast is determined by the slowest runner. I mean, not in the marathon, in what you call it, the relay race. Your speed is decided by the slowest runner, not the fastest runner, okay? Like what lots of people may think, okay? So if the slowest runner decides the overall speed, okay? No matter how much the other person performs, the slowest runner is going to determine how fast the team can progress, okay? So this designer wanted to remove the slowest runner. So what they thought, anyway, I'm going to do processing all the content, I don't need the six. So they wanted to convert this disk into tape. So the concept of, so there's a new terminology called disk as tape. So what they wanted to do, they wanted to do a bulk transfer. So big files are divided into bigger blocks of 64 MB, okay, and they are kept, okay, and the processing is not going to do a random seeks. The processing is always goes to, it starts from here, reads the entire 64 MB, takes it into memory and process, read 64 MB, and inside it, it does only a sequential read, because according to Hadoop, your data is nothing like a list. And to do any activity, we have to look into entire data set. Okay. And if I have to do the look into entire data set, what is more efficient way of doing it? Sequential. This is the most efficient way of doing it if I have to read the entire data set. Is it?
Yeah, I have one question. So generally, like whenever we get the data from like external systems, so do we have to perform like batch processing on the Hadoop and then store the data to the Hbase, or we can do batch processing even on Hbase as well?
Okay, let's put batch processing. I said it's just an example. I mean, just a, it's a terminology. Okay. Okay. What happens is it is not a batch, it is called a MapReduce, and the batch processing, I said batch processing because sequential processing is, people always have thought batch processing into the concept of sequential processing. Okay. If I have 100 records, I read all the 100 records. So why we call it as a batch processing is it's not interactive. Interactive is like if I have 100 records, I need only two or three of them, it is not batch, it is like a random reads. Okay, so that's an example, that is just an just to give an analogy, say that batch processing, but predominantly what we call as a map reduce, and map reduce is sequential in nature, and when data comes in, if you are writing any map reduce, that is done in sequential, and this sequential data can be pushed into Hbase, and that is also in a sequential manner.
Okay.
Got. So it will be like this. Okay, I'll just draw. Okay. There will be multiple streams of data. Okay, this is what we call streams of data. They all push into a HDFS cluster. Okay, on this cluster you run MapReduce. You again push data, the output is pushed into, so HDFS plus you can push into Hbase. If you push into Hbase, other applications which needs interactive data, they contact Hbase directly and then get a data. Say for example,
okay.
So the streams of data in HDFS clusters, let me complete it once again. Say for example, if this had 1 billion rows, okay, MapReduce processing it. Okay, let's for example, it is transformed into, say for example, 500 million rows. It's pushed into Hbase. This application needs 1 row out of 500 million, then use Hbase. Okay, MapReduce is used in places where to do transformation you do MapReduce. Also, if you want to know how many of the 1 billion is below poverty line, if you have to do this query, you do MapReduce. Okay, because that access the entire data set. Okay, got it?
Yeah. So, like from the HDFS cluster, like if you are doing any kind of transformations, like from the MapReduce, from the MapReduce, we can directly push it down to the Hbase, or it has to be from the HDFS cluster. We have to.
Yes, MapReduce to Hbase can be directly. I mean, it has two-step process. Okay. So MapReduce to HDFS, you cannot push directly to Hbase. Okay. You write to HDFS, and from HDFS you push to MapReduce. But in the new release of Hbase, what they did is, from Hbase itself, you can run a MapReduce, so that intermediate step can be eliminated. That is, you directly run MapReduce from Hbase on the HDFS cluster, so the output is directly written to an Hbase table.
Okay.
That is possible now. In the last 3 months or 4 months, they made such kind of an capabilities.
Okay.
Got it?
Yeah.
Mani, I have one more question here then.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give some more example? As you said for Hbase, if you have, say in HDFS, you have 1 million of records, and half million you pushed into the Hbase from HDFS. Mm-hmm. So you just get two scenarios. One scenario is like if you want to capture one row from that half million rows.
I'll give you an example. You are based out of you're currently following what is happening in India, right?
See,
we have other project, that is a UID project. Okay, I have also worked on that UID project. I was designing the Hbase, the data model for the other projects. Okay. So here, like a social security number, okay, it's like, say money goes in, and then I put my fingerprints and then give a retina scan, it needs to immediately know this is money, which means out of 1 billion record, one record has to be matched, okay? So this is where Hbase comes in. So the other aspect of it is, I have this whole Indian's data, and then you need to do some kind of a MapReduce, I mean do some kind of an analytics, okay? How many of them are, how many people do you think will migrate in the next year from the urban to the rural? Okay.
So do you mean like we can do predictive analytics, something like that you are talking?
Yes. All those kind of things, anything that needs processing the whole data, you write it as a MapReduce on the HDFS cluster directly. Hbase mostly the result of lots of other transformation wherein you need data, and then in a real time you need to access the data, you use Hbase.
Yeah,
got
that's
it?
Fine. And so see, say in my, I'm working for one of the storage company. And their log files are coming from the one shared storage, and Zoom is pushing the data into HDFS. Okay, so I don't know how they are bifurcating the some information from that log files, since that log file contains it's like a 62 section, and out of that 62 section, one section contains configuration related information. And that information they are taking from HDFS to Hbase.
That's very simple,
right? Hbase. So any business rule they are writing or what kind of things? Because I'm not aware of
Let's put it like this. Okay, since you are not part of Map Hadoop class, okay, I'll going to oversimplify this. Okay, see, this is a row. Let's take this as a row. Okay, it has like 0 to 63 columns, okay? Okay, so what we do in a MapReduce is you write two functions, one is map and one is reduce. In the map function, what we predominantly do is called, you do transformation, okay, and key value form permission, okay? So in your problem it is only transformation. Say for example, you are only interested in 43rd field. Okay. Now what happened is, map, you get this record. Okay, all that you are going to do is string data equal to record of 43. I'm writing pseudocode, okay, this is not a real code. Okay, then what you do, context.write data. Okay, so reduce, since there is no reduce logic, it is just going to write context.write of data. So what will happen is, this record after this MapReduce program will be converted into just data 43. Like this it will be there. Then somebody would have written a simple program, simple 10 line program that read this file and call hbase.put record of y. Okay, so for example, for I equals 0, I less than n, I plus plus. Okay, so now this, if you have 1 billion rows, here you will have 1 billion rows in Hbase, but only column 43. Okay, got it right? I just oversimplified it, but yes, if you are part of the Hadoop class, you will be able to write this code actually.
Okay.
Got it right?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. Any other doubts?
But I will ask you.
Okay, so set up Hadoop, set up Hbase. So for these two things, the prerequisite would be like Java should be set up and should be set up Eclipse. Okay, predominantly. So I think everybody is. I'll tell you the plan. Okay, the plan. If everybody is having Windows machine, download VMware Player. Okay, and then install Ubuntu 12.10 in that. Okay, and then install Java in the same order. Okay, install Java. Okay, install Hadoop, install Hbase. After Java you install Ant. Okay, install Hadoop, install Hbase, install Eclipse. Okay, so this is how you should do it. Everything is free. You don't need to pay for anything. Okay, VMware Player is free. Okay.
After Java, you said Ant, right?
Yes. Ant. This is for your build and compile. Okay. This is for build and compile. We use Ant. Okay. So on this table, you can do a MapReduce, which essentially means that your input can be anything, but your output would be this table. Essentially, MapReduce, what people do is that reduce will write to the text file. So in Hbase implementation, what happens is that the reduce will do a put command. A put command will put right into Hbase. Okay, so if you search for Hbase table reduce, you might get some Google links to that. Okay. Got it? So the actual class name is called HTable Reducer. HTable. This is the diagram that we looked into last week. So this is where we concluded, kind of. Okay, we wanted to understand what are the different kinds of systems based on the CAP theorem. Okay, so Hbase formally. Okay, so formally Hbase. Okay, so Hbase is a, let's understand Hbase. Okay, Hbase. Okay, so Hbase is, what are we trying? It is telling that this is an open source. It is a horizontally scalable sorted map built on top of Apache Hadoop. Okay, there's too much of technology jargon, right? Open source because it is an Apache project, so that is understood. Second is horizontally scalable. Okay, why we don't call, so we need to understand why and how. Don't just take, because I'm telling Hbase is horizontally scalable, don't just assume it. Okay, you need to understand that why it is horizontally scalable and how it is horizontally scalable. Is there any other databases that is horizontally scalable? And if not, why they are not horizontally scalable? Okay, so all these questions has to be understood. Okay, and this is what I'm going to give this exercise. Okay, so understand what is horizontal. This is an exercise. Okay, exercise for next class. Well, understand what does
Mani, can you say,
yes,
can you tell what is scalable in terms of Hbase?
What is
scalable in terms of Hbase?
Sorry, I didn't hear you properly.
See, Hbase supports horizontal or and linear scalable. Yes, scalable, correct. So okay. I mean, I just
scalable.
Wanted to understand.
CA. This is scalable. That is, say for example, when I say horizontally scalable, which means that I have 100 records. At that time, I had one machine. If I have 200 records, the same one machine can work. When I have 300 records, I need two machines. Okay. When I put this two machine, whether this will work out or this won't work out, which means that if I have two machines, whether it becomes 150 in one machine, 150 in another machine, so the load gets shared, or 200 in one machine, remaining 100 in another machine. So here what happens is that you don't know how the load gets distributed. It's not horizontally linearly scalable, okay? So which means that all the machines that I keep also, two things should satisfy. As data grows, my system should scale without problem by adding more hardware and function smoothly. That is, it should be able to read properly, write. When read, it needs to know where the data is. When write, it needs to know where. Okay, since it is horizontally scalable, any one machine can fail. And what will happen when one machine fails? Okay, all those things has to be answered. When they say horizontally scalable, it is not just it is just a jargon, but between this jargon there are too many things that needs to be properly understood. Okay, that is why I am saying completely understand what does it mean by horizontally scalable and what all things a machine should a system should guarantee so that horizontal scalability can be worked out. Okay, that is an exercise I'm telling. Is it clear now?
Yes, it is clear.
Okay, the second thing that what you are telling is that this is a sorted map. Okay, this is the most important thing that we need to understand. Okay, why we call this a sorted map? Okay, as I said, people wanted. Okay, how RDBMS work? Okay, inside this RDBMS, say for example, if I have 1000 records, how RDBMS is able to retrieve a single record? Anybody knows? Don't say SQL, SQL is just only an interface. Okay, so internally it uses lots of B+tree algorithm. Okay, to search. Search a key. Okay, now, so this is a complex. So this was B+tree is good for random data. Okay, because your data has to be first a seed and then found. So these guys also have concept of index. If they go use this index and then find which sector location it may be available and then that's it. Okay. So all these things are possible. Okay. Now, because the data is random data, it is stored randomly. Okay. Now, here when we store the data in a sequential manner, okay, I don't need this kind of structure. So what I can do is that I can have a hash map, okay, and not just simple hash map, it's a sorted hash map. So what I do, I have 100 records, 1000 records, I represent them as a hash map. Okay, so there is a key and there is a value, and since it is a sorted hash map, and this can be also persisted, okay, that is stored. So all I'm building here is a distributed hash map. For 40 years people try to build distributed hash table, DHT. Just even type DHT, distributed hash table, and then see how many research papers have been written. Enormous amount of research paper, but nobody built any successful DHT. The reason they want to build DHT on regular file system. In Google, engineers decided that to have DHT, the prerequisite is distributed file system. Okay, without a distributed file system, you cannot have a distributed hash table, because your hash table is limited by your memory, but your data is thousands of time higher than RAM. Okay, so what we have to do, though you hash table can get all your data in order of one, you cannot keep this entire data in a hash table. So you need a distributed hash table so that pieces of data is in okay, pieces of hash table is in all machine. Since it's sorted, key based index will work, will help which key is in which hash table. Okay, so it will be like, instead of having one hash table, like 1 to 1 billion, what we have is that we have a, say for example, is hashed, so we just have a simple entry wherein we say that key range is 0 to 100 is in hash table 1. 100 to 700 is in hash table 2, 701 to 10,000 in hash table 3. Like this, we can keep an entry and then you can do it.
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
It's clear, right?
Yes.
Okay, so that is what we are saying. Okay, data model inspired and similar to Google's Bigtable. Goal is to provide a quick random read and write across massive amount of data. It is layered over HDFS, that is your distributed file system, and it is tolerant of machine failure. Let's understand tolerant of machine failure. Okay, little bit more. Okay, when we say tolerant of machine failure. So it is less. So we saw it, right? What? So in the last thing, what we saw.
So Mani, just I wanted to interrupt here. As you said, yes. Like it's a sorted map. So it's a sorted in yes. Descending order. Is that correct?
Any order. It's a sorted hash map. Your view can mean anything. Okay, sorting is sorting. Okay. When you say ascending or descending, it is only how you view the data. Okay. Array doesn't have beginning or end. Okay. I mean, array doesn't have this is beginning and this is end. Beginning and this is only in our mind and in the code. In the RAM, a computer can read an array from both the directions.
Okay.
So if you want ascending order, it will read from left to right. If you want descending order, it may read from left to right, right to left.
Then how this sorted map justify the Hbase? I mean, just can you
okay, let us do. Let's do
can
that.
You
one, okay.
Yeah, please.
Yes, I let's draw that. Okay. Say for example, I have 1 billion rows. Okay, to store. And process. Okay, this is the problem that we have to have. Okay, then we say that RDBMS cannot do it. Okay, RDBMS simply cannot do it. Then what else is possible? Somebody says that okay, you know what? We can have hash map. Okay, then we say that hash map as a limited by RAM. Which at the maximum it can be 64 GB. Okay, even 64 GB could not store it. Okay, then what else we can do? Then we say that okay, we will have multiple machines. Somebody says that okay, these multiple machines are no use because my hash map can be only in one machine. It cannot be in two machines. Then somebody says that okay, let us build a because we have already built a distributed file system, let us also build a distributed hash table. Then somebody says that, okay, conceptually, let us have the hash map like this. That is like 0 to a billion entry. And let us break this hash map into smaller hash maps. And this hash map is in machine 1. This is in machine 2. And this in machine 3, machine 4. Then somebody says that if it is this way, since in a hash map, there is no guarantee that record 1 will be here and record 2 will be here and 3 will be here. Because it's a hash key, it can be in anywhere. So which means that locating the data will become complex. So somebody said, so the people think that, so let us not have a hash map. We have a sorted hash map. Okay. If I have a sorted hash map, now what I can have here is that I will have a partitioner. Okay. So this guy will know given a key which range it falls into. Say for example, if I give a key called 23, it will say, it will not know whether 23 is in either this machine, this machine, this machine, this machine. But what it will know here is that since it is in a sorted hash map, we will have stored the range 0 to 50 here, 51 to 100 here, 101 to 200 here. So when 23 comes, guaranteed it will say it should be in M2. I mean, the place to look for is M2. Whether it is there or not, you figure it out. If M2 says the data is not there, I'm sorry, M1. If M1 says the data is not there, don't even look into any other things, because M2 starting data itself is 51. So it's only prices M1. This is the guarantee that is provided by the hash map, okay? And so the last part what you want to understand is that machine failures.
Yeah, so I just wanted to conclude here, like as you said, it's a sorted hash map. So definitely, since we are knowing the this data is falling under some particular range, so it will help us to help us in access retrieval.
Yes, it is going to help you in faster retrieval.
Yeah.
So that is, so by the time we come to next class, I want everybody to learn one thing. It is called consistent hashing. You need to know this concept. Okay, I'll explain you, but just Google for consistent hashing and then read about consistent hashing. And this consistent hashing is going to help you. This is what is going to help come over here, okay? This is going to make sure that which key goes to which machine, okay? Decided. Okay, so read about this consistent hashing, that is what internally used here. Okay, so that is one. So machine failures, that's the last thing here. Okay, this machine failure, okay. So what we did when we, so when we talked about machine failure somewhere here. When we talked about linear scalable, right? When you talked about linear scalable, when data was 100, we had one machine. When data was 200, we had M2 also, which means that 1 to 100 is in one machine, 101 to 200 is in another machine. Okay. Now, from an application perspective, it sees data from 1 to 200. Okay. Now, this, since there are two different machines, this machine can fail independent of this machine. When this machine fails, half of your data is lost. Okay. So, in order to avoid this kind of a scenarios, what people generally do, when all these systems that are linearly scalable, yes, this is scalable. So, this is one portion and this is another portion. So, they will have a replica. So they'll have a replica. Okay, so even if this machine fails, this machine should take over it. Okay, so this is like all linearly scalable machines should have a mechanism for failure handling. Okay, so that is, so that is Hbase is direct, is by default Hadoop provides replication, and then Hbase leverages those replication mechanism to save it from machine failures. So this is one of the differences that we need to understand. HDFS is a distributed file system. Yes, tell me.
So can you give some, yeah, can you give some real-time scenario where we can go for HDFS?
So real-time scenario is
some use case.
Some use case. If the data is really big, it can be anything. Say for example, how does Facebook store all its internal data? How does LinkedIn store its internal data? How does PayPal or anybody else storing lots of their data? They are all putting it in Hbase so that they can do it for an interactive queries. your next product recommendation, so many things. They use Hbase to store their and retrieve data, your user information. Other project is using Hbase. There's the Government of India's UID project is using Hbase to store and retrieve all our UIDs.
Yeah, social media company is using Hbase. Yeah, I'm aware of that. Yeah.
Yes. Lots of them are using Hbase because Hbase provides the kind of a scalability that is needed.
Okay.
Mani, are you aware of any financial institution usage of Hbase?
Financial institutions using of Hbase, there is direct financial, I don't. But PayPal uses Hbase a lot. Okay, if you call PayPal as a financial institute, they do lots of financial calculating things. They use Hbase a lot. I worked with the project with PayPal, so I know internally they use Hbase a lot.
So, Mani, Hbase access data randomly. So, it's access sequentially or randomly?
It's a hash table, okay, so it is not even random, it is an order of one lookup, it is a direct lookup that you do.
Okay.
So it is much more better than random also. It's a direct lookup.
Okay.
If you say get employee 17, it directly knows which machine will have that 17 and then it goes directly grabs the data and gives it back.
It's something like index, right? Directly I'm putting zeroth element I want, so it will give you the zeroth.
Yes, you can get it. That's what we call as a hash table.
Okay. So that's the reason why it is fast for lookup as well. Like we can update any record
even
very
index
fast.
What we'll be doing is that in index also, you will just do a binary search on the index and then get it. But here it is directly. So HDFS versus Hbase, okay? Lots of time people have confusion. Okay, HDFS is just a file system, okay, it's a distributed file system and where you can put huge amount of a file, but the HDFS file system natively provides only sequential access to data. Okay, Hbase is a database and it is written over HDFS, okay, and Hbase is a database for faster record lookup, okay. And Hbase internally puts data in an index store file that exists on HDFS for high speed lookup, okay. It is like Oracle is a database, but then for Oracle it needs your operating system and then it needs a physical disk. And for all practical purpose for the operating system, it doesn't matter whether it is an Oracle's file or any other application's file too. The operating system treats those files as the same. It's only Oracle treats that its files in a different manner. It's in the same way. HDFS treats everything as a normal file. For Hbase, it stores its own data in as an HDFS file. That is the only difference here. Got the clarity, right?
Yeah. So Hbase is a incremental database. So I mean.
Yes, you can add incremental data.
Yeah, but the idea here is HDFS is also incremental. We can keep adding the data. We can keep dumping the data.
Yes, you can keep adding. But what is differentiating factor is not about the incremental addition of data. It is on the available data. Can I do a pointed query? If I have 100 million records, if I want to look one record in that, HDFS doesn't provide any functionalities natively to do that. Okay.
Yeah.
So HDFS is not designed for it. Even if you have to do it, you have to process the 100 million data to get that one data. So this is the higher level architecture for Hbase. So there is an HDFS file system, there is a zookeeper, and then there is a Hbase. So Hbase is written over HDFS file system. And zookeeper, I'll talk about zookeeper later, but for now understand zookeeper is nothing but a coordination service. So it takes care of making sure whether every system in the overall system is in sync with each other. That is, no system should have failed and dependent systems should all be up. All these things are done by a coordination server, that is a zookeeper.
Okay.
And inside the Hbase, there is a three different pieces that you will see. One is an Hmaster, okay, and one is an region server, okay. And then there is like an application programming interfaces, APIs. so that you can connect to Hbase from a Java program and then read the data and things like that. Okay. So Hmaster, so the master, and then there are lots of region servers. Okay, there will be one master and there will be multiple region servers. So inside the region server, there are three components. One is an H file and one is a mem store and another one is a write ahead log. Okay, we'll talk about all these things in detail as we go.
So you will also talk more details in about Zookeeper going further.
No, Zookeeper I will not talk much more here because I'll talk only what role it does for Hbase. Zookeeper itself is another thing. If you have to learn about Zookeeper, it is far complex and it will take at least like it will take a 2-day course to cover Zookeeper and its functionality and then how to write code using Zookeeper and what are all
okay,
the
no, I just I just wanted to understand like see in a clouded I was trying to run Hbase. So Hbase was not running.
Zookeeper will start.
Hbase was started and Zookeeper was started and Hbase was down. So what I did like I stopped Zookeeper and then I started Hbase. It started working then Hbase. So I just wanted to know like
Zookeeper needs to run. You need Zookeeper only when you are running Hbase in a fully clustered mode. So in a single instance box, you have to run Hbase in a pseudo cluster mode. And in a pseudo cluster mode, you cannot use Zookeeper. So you have to stop Zookeeper and run the Hbase.
Yeah, that's true. So, why we are using Zookeeper?
Zookeeper is to make sure that, say, Zookeeper is a coordination server, okay? In a distributed system, Zookeeper acts, make sure that every party that is agreed to work together should work together. It is like a program manager in our office, okay? A program manager makes sure if there is one project that needs 5 teams to work together, the program manager doesn't do any work apart from looking into whether the 5 teams are working as they have to work. If there is any delay in one team, the delay will be mitigated to all the other teams. So everybody is know about this delay. Everybody will adjust their plans. All those things should happen, right? It is the same role a Zookeeper is doing in an automatic. We try to understand what is a table, what is a row, what is a column. Okay. So the fundamental basic unit is a column. Okay. So your column is in Hbase. A name column is composed of two things, a name and a value. Okay, this forms the column. Okay, say it's the same thing as our regular RDBMS also. Okay, let's start. RDBMS data is looked like this. ID, column 1, column 2, column 3. Like this column again, okay. So it is like that. It starts from 1 to n, and no matter what. So this is how it will be like. So all rows. So this is a column. So this is a column. This is a column. Okay. This is column. So what happens is that one row, each row has all the columns, okay. So that is how our traditional way of looking into it. And the main problem in the traditional model is that number of columns are fixed, okay. Yes, we can have a flexible schema, but it is very difficult. Flexible schema, yes. Dynamically at runtime have more columns. Okay, these are some of the capabilities which are, though it can be done in RDBMS, it is not designed for doing it. Okay, but Hbase is going to help you do all those things. Okay, so in the previous RDBMS model, there are two things that are clearly as a problem. One is sparseness. We assume that the model assumes that all rows should have all columns. with Hbase, the concept becomes, okay. Each row might have different columns. How is this possible? Okay, so the possible is this model cannot work then. This model of ID column 1 to column n, this model cannot work. So there is a flaw in this model. This model will not work for unlimited columns or not having null put in place where a column is not needed. Okay, so how do we do this? Okay, so only if you are able to do it, then we will be able to, so we'll have much more benefit. Okay, so now Hbase should propose a different alternative schema. So this is not a schema, the storage mechanism. So what it tries to do is that, so it becomes little flexible. Okay, so now what it did, you still have the concept of you still have the row id, and rather than column 1 to column n, they change this concept and then they propose a new model. So the new model is, we say we have ID and we say we are not going to say it's a column, we say column family. Okay, then we have it. So this can be ID 1. So inside here, in all our traditional model, a cell has value for that row, for that column. Okay, so here what happens is that this cell, a cell has values of, or something like a cell has a collection or list of name value for that ID. So instead of column, we call column family. So an example can be personal info. Okay, personal info. So what would have been a table here called personal info, it becomes a column family. So personal info can be, so for ID 1, this guy can have age, he can have gender, he can have blood group. Okay, all these three things will be there. For somebody has an ID 2, this guy might have age, gender. What is the third thing I wrote? I forgot. Okay, age, gender, blood group, martial status, pictures, etc. Okay, so for this guy 3 columns, for this guy 5 columns. It is still possible because this is Hbase. So this is the kind of a model that we are going to work on. And this model, if you write it in Java, people must be thinking this is very similar things. Okay, so this is nothing but a hash map of string, comma, hash map of string, string. This is your Hbase. Okay, so what it tells, this hash map, the data, it looks like this. One is your ID and then followed by name, age, gender. Okay, 2 is your ID followed by name, age, gender, B group, bio, picture. Like this, the data will be. Okay, so this is the most important understanding that needs to be understood. So it, the cell is having a collection of name value pairs in Hbase. In your regular RDBMS, the cell has a single value for the particular row and for the particular column. Any doubts here so far?
I have one question. I'm not sure like if it is too early to ask this one, but see now, mm-hmm. because the table structure is so different from regular RDBMS, now mm-hmm. because in regular RDBMS, if I want to perform just the where class, and like example would be like age less than 18.
Right question. Very good question. Okay, yeah, continue.
Yeah, so if I want to perform like the where class, like age less than 17 and gender equal to mm-hmm. male, is it possible to run such kind of queries?
Okay, there is yes and no. Okay, the first question, the first answer is there is no concept of queries. There is no concept of queries in Hbase, or for most of the NoSQL databases, there is no concept of queries. Okay, but without query, it is very difficult to write any of these things. So the concept that we are going to see is called as a filters. Okay, so you need to write some Java programs to get those kind of an answer that you want. Predominantly, the default function provided by Hbase is only get. It's a hash table. Okay, in a hash table, do you write queries? In a hash table, you only look on the key. You don't even search a hash table based on the values. You search a hash table only based on keys. So Hbase also provides a base functionality as search only by the keys, and what you are asking for is search based on their values. Okay, the query filter, where class is nothing but searching based on the values. Okay, so hold on to the question. That's a very nice question to ask, because you have to know that when you are using Hbase, what are all the things you need to forethink. Okay, if this guy is telling like this, how a query can happen, that's a nice thought to happen, because the query is not simply possible because it's a hash table. In the hash table, you can't write queries. Okay, so and there is one more thing is that there is no concept of fixed columns. When you don't have the columns of fixed column, you don't have what you call as a schema. And if you don't have a schema, you cannot write what you call as an SQL compiler. And SQL compilation can only happen only if the compiler knows the schemas of a table. Then only it can build a query plan, it can build any execution plan and everything. Okay, when all these things are not there, nothing will happen. So it's a very good question and then rightly asked. We will touch upon those areas of how to access the data, surpassing the limit that we don't have a query or we don't have the capability to search on the data. And we will be using a concept called filters, and we'll be using two filters. One is your client-side filters and one is your server-side filters. We'll talk about it when we start writing code.
Okay, sure. Like one more question is like, you know, if I want to perform like sorting also, like say for example, like I want to get the list of all these rows sorted by age. So even such kind of things are also possible?
Again, yes and no. It's like you have to write such kind of code. It is not directly possible. You have to write Java code.
So someone like, I mean, like we can tweak the code and get those results.
It's not trick. Actually, you have to write logic. It's not like something is a trick there.
Okay.
You just have to write code. As I said, it is server-side filters, or it's a filter, right? You get back the data, and then after you get back the data, sorting is up to you on whichever column you need to sort it. Okay. The Hbase engine is not going to do that for you. Your Java code is going to do that for you.
Okay.
And you have to understand it is, Hbase is a very recent new product. Okay, it is like asking whether Oracle even didn't have results at 10 years or 12 years back. Okay, and Oracle has been used for almost 25 years now. So, asking all those functionalities of rich RDBMS in a product that doesn't even have 1.0 version is asking too much. Okay, you have to constantly understand that Hbase is still only 0.8 or 0.9. It's not even 1.0. So maybe 5 years down the line, lots of functionalities would have get added. But at that time, we will be much more comfortable with Hbase. It is like somebody who has worked in Oracle for 20 years, they must be having more knowledge about the product, right? And they would have seen the product from its initial stages. Like somebody would have worked on Oracle 1.0, they might know that what was there in 1.0 and then how in their old days they used to work with Oracle. So today we are at that particular point in time wherein we will be able to tell to the younger people 10 years down the line that, you know what, I worked in a database which doesn't even had a query. Okay, so that is how you will be, the product will evolve.
Thanks.
Any other doubts?
I have one question. See, here you mentioned 1, 2. So this one is a column denoting to row keys or column family?
That's a row. One is row, two is, one is a column, but since I put this in ID, it is like this. This whole thing is row, sorry, the line got screwed up.
Okay.
This is a row. So this can be another column family. There can be another column family. The most basic unit is a column. One or more columns form a row that is addressed uniquely by a row key. A number of rows in turn form a table. Okay. Each column can have multiple versions. Okay. We will talk about all these things. Rows are composed of columns and those in terms are grouped into column families. Family qualifier. Okay, so it is that's the concept. Okay, let us just understand one more thing. So we have the concept of row. Okay, row is a collection of column family. Okay, and for the table. Column families, okay. The column family is a collection of key value pairs, also called as columns. Okay, a column is nothing but a key value. Okay, so conceptually it looks like this table. Okay, in every table has something called as a row ID. This is your primary key, followed by multiple column families. Column family. So it can be 1, 2, 3, and each column family is a collection of 1.n kv pair that it can be name, age, gender. So this column family can be base salary, HRA, DA, etc. This can be your profile info, CV, salary info. This can be your another column family. This can be your bank account. Things like that. So there is no limit on how many column families, and there is no limit of how many columns inside a column family for a particular row can be there. And there is no mandate that every row should have all the column families. So the second row might not have anything. It can just only have bank information alone. Section 3, the row ID 3 can have this and this, and the remaining things cannot be there. Okay, so this is the flexibility of your Hbase. And so is it clear?
Okay.
Because we don't have the concept of a fixed schema, we don't need to store null. If it's not there, let's not store it. If I now don't find the field, which means that the field is not there. So there is no reason why I have to put a null.
Okay.
And if I put null, you know what, then every column family or every row should have all the columns. That is one benefit we will be losing. Today every row can have different columns. Because I don't have any mandate that I have to store all the columns, and then if the value is not there, I have to put a null. I'll just ignore those columns that doesn't is not there for a particular. So this is an example of how it looks like. Okay, we'll talk about this slide at a little later stage. Okay, this is the conceptual model. Okay. What is there in RDBMS? If you see row C, for column C it had null. If we see the down picture, row A has column A value, column B value. Okay, then I can move to the next slide.
Yeah, Mani, here we have two column family. I'm seeing in Hbase, your column A and column B for row A. And we have the separate value. Is that correct, no? For all the for column A, column family value is B value, column B, column family value is value, and the and we can access through row A. Is this my understanding?
No. Let's put this way. Column in the RDBMS there are column A, B, C, D. Okay.
Yeah.
So here what we are saying here is that we are having only two column family 1 and family 2. Okay. So row A has column A's value. Okay. And in family 1 and in family 2 it has column B's value. Okay. If you see row B has column B's value, and see row B doesn't have any column A's value, which is also possible.
But for row B, ideally even the column B should be in family, because here like in the picture it shows for the row B, column B is in family 1. But whereas
there is no need for mandate here, right? It can just have any values. Okay, so there is no mandate here on what data should go. Okay, that's what in this example it would have been much more clearer. If you see here. Same. In ideal scenario, let's say for example, let's put a name to this column families. So this was like personal info. We call HR info. We call this as a bio info. So this is bank info. In a traditional data, we would have had 5 tables. We have an employee info table, we have employee ID, then we have a personal info table, it has employee ID is a foreign key and remaining fields. Like this we would have had 5 tables. Okay, and to get any data we need to do a join and get data. Okay, now here in this one, say for example, if you want to get a query like get all employee salary greater than say for example 50,000 who has 10-year experience and joined from Pune. To write this query, I need to join this, all the 5 tables has to be joined. Okay. So in this world, in Hbase, this query is very easy because with just one row key, I can access all the column families. All I need to say is that column family 1 dot has field something salary greater than 200 to 50,000 have it. So the query may look bigger, but then there is no joins because the row key get all the column families for that key in one shot. So you get everything without even doing a join. That is when we say that Hbase joins are, I mean, there is a much more efficient way of doing queries, because we take the eliminate, we remove the dependency on joins to a large extent. Is that clear now? Hello?
Yeah, it's clear. So as per my understanding, this column family is helping to remove join?
That is one way of looking into it, yes. But over a period of time, you will understand quite a lot, okay?
Yeah,
that's it. Is like this, okay? When you start learning numbers, we think numbers are just for counting. But over a period of time, we'll start to understand numbers are different. It is just not for counting, and it's like that. Okay. Slowly, our understanding will build up over the end of the course. We'll understand what exactly column families are. But to start with, your understanding is fine, perfectly fine. A column family, for all practical purpose, is a convenient replacement for the concept of tables in RDBMS. So in RDBMS, we will have database and tables. So here, it is just a database and a table, but table has multiple column families. So what can happen is that you avoid dealing with multiple tables. One table, multiple column families is a good start. Say for in traditional world, you want to have three tables to do any operations. In Hbase world, what we can do is that those three tables can be clubbed into a single table, and each one of them can be in individual column families. So you can avoid a lot of joint kind of a queries. Is it answered your question? This is a much more detailed explanation of the simple hash table that I wrote, okay? So just read this hash table, read this slide once. Spend some five minutes reading this slide. We can express data, access the data like this. Table, first you have to tell what table you want, what row key, what family, what column, and which timestamp. This gives you value. Okay. You're getting it right. So to get a data, like traditional word, you have to tell what table, what row. Then you can say which column family, which column, and condition. Okay, like this you can actually, the data lookup plan is like this always. So previously I said Hbase is very simple. It is a hash map of string, hash map of string comma string. Okay, so this concept is, this is a base concept, but then the actual concept is like this. Okay, so you have a hash map of string, this is your key, and then we saw in Hbase it's a collection of multiple column families, so you have to represent column families. Now again we put hash map of string. This string is your column family. And then you have to again have the concept of multiple columns. So that can be told by hash map of string string. So this is your column and this is the value. So row key and 1.n column family, and each column family has 1.n columns. Okay, then we have the concept. So this is what is shown here. If you see, it is sorted. If you see here, it is a sorted map, row key, list of sorted map. There is a list, I didn't do it because this list is for your timestamp is coming in, right? So we have, so some of the examples of where Hbase was used. The first index, first reason Hbase was invented was to create a for the search project, okay? For Google, when they wanted to implement their search, it was designed for search, okay? So they need to have a database to store the inverted index. Okay, so for that inverted index, they need to have a database, because Google, to do searching, it needs to do crawling, and then it needs to create inverted index. The inverted index was created by MapReduce, but then the inverted index has to be accessed in real time on so at an extremely fast rate, okay, in a random access manner. That is when they created a whole database that is called a big table, and the Hbase is an implementation of this big table in an open source manner. Okay, so this is how it started. This is an example of Hbase. Okay, we'll look into these things later. Shredding, automatic load balancing, we've seen it. Okay, we'll look into it again. Okay. So right now, what is needed here is a little bit of hands-on, since okay, so that's one point where we can't progress now, because we need the Hbase installation to be there. Okay. The remaining part, if I have to cover before covering it, I need to have a little bit of hands-on. Then only we'll be able to understand other details. Okay. So what I want to do here is all these things will make sure only when we have a little bit hands-on. Okay, we have to have the Hbase installation done.
You mentioned that installation, we need to install the Eclipse. It is on Windows, or we need to install on Linux itself?
Everything, when whatever I talk, is only under Ubuntu. Apart from the VMware player, everything else is installed inside Ubuntu. Creating some tables, putting some data, reading the data, all those things. The theory will be understanding, explaining those different components that is there in Hbase. Then we will get into programming with Hbase. That's the major part of it. Okay.
I have one question. So now, say, like, because we have to write like some of the MapReduce programs to get that data, right? So now, say, like, I have like.
No. Wait. You don't need to write MapReduce to get data from Hbase. You write MapReduce on HDFS file and push the output of that into Hbase.
Okay. So how to access the data, we have to just use some APIs?
Get and put, that's it. It's a hash table.
Okay.
All you need to do is get, put, delete.
Okay. Okay, so now say like we have like a lot of rows, say like we have 1 billion rows, but now where class returns, I'm saying like typical like existing how it works in RDBMS is like.
Yes, that where class is not directly supported. For right. That, you need to write something called as a filters.
Right.
So you will say, so there are only four operations in Hbase: get, put, scan, and delete. Okay. Get is only a get function. It can take a key and return back. Scan take has something called as a filter. In the filter, you can see what fields and what value it should satisfy. Okay, to get back the data. That is what we call as a custom filters.
Okay. Yeah, but now say like in typical thing, what would happen is like we will write like all the pagination logic and the sorting logic on the Oracle, and then get the data. So in that case, like. On the client side, we are just fetching like only like 25 rows or 50 rows or at the most 100 rows.
Yeah, same thing you have to do for Hbase also.
In the Hbase also, like everything works on the distributed system, and at the end, like whatever the page says, we mention only those many records we can fetch.
You have to write all the Java code yourself for doing that.
Okay. Yeah, but
what is there is they have a function called a limit. So you can say that how many rows you have to limit it.
Okay, so even though we write like the custom code, still we can make sure like that logic is executing on the delay.
Yeah, Krishna, I have just posted one scan how it works, and how you can, you can limit also. I mean, this is a one criteria you can consider it.
Yeah.
Okay.
like this is your date 2013 01 02, so this, I mean, hours, till millisecond you can do that.
Okay, okay.
So this is like your scan, this is table name, asset tracking, and then you are, this is your column, there you are mentioning meta, that is main table actually. Asset ID is the column, it's like a column qualifier, and here we are mentioning a start, so that is nothing but it's my date.
Okay, if there are no further questions, we can end the session today.
One more question actually. You okay. mentioned that we need to write MapReduce and then load the data into Hbase, right?
Not always, but you can write MapReduce and
Yeah, MapReduce only reads the one file format, or it can read more than one file format?
It can read any kind of file formats, up to you.
No, at the same time, right? I'm asking, at the same time, can it read more than one file format?
At the same time, if you read more than one file format, you can chain it actually. Multiple file formats, you can chain one after another.
So we have to write two maps, or how is that?
Yes, two maps.